B. This is your host, Grace B, coming to you from New York City, the city that never sleeps and is home to Cancer Convos with Grace B. As you all know, my show aims to demystify the cancer disease by bringing on experts and stakeholders to give their valid takes and opinions on this very terrible disease, and also to promote healthy ways of keeping it at bay. On today's show, we shall be discussing very vital and pertinent issues to our existence, which happens to be our mindset and nutrition, and how they relate to and affect our healing and recovery from chronic diseases. With me to educate us on this is my next guest, a very well-known coach and trainer, a motivational speaker and author. She is the founder, Alison Harris Wellbeing, based in the United Kingdom. The proverbial saying, "you are what you eat," underscores the fact that food has a very strong bearing on one's physical and mental health. And Alison will be telling us exactly what this means and how her mindset and her change in diet and nutrition affected her healing and helped with her own health challenges. So, without much ado, I welcome Alison to the show. Welcome, Alison, to Cancer Convos with Grace B, and thank you ever so much for joining me. I can't wait for us to dive straight into this topic.
Well, thank you for having me. This is my first video, so it's out of my comfort zone, this is completely, but...
Wow, you're welcome. And I must say, you actually look very, very amazing. I love this color on you.
Thank you.
Yes, you do. So let's dive straight into this talk. Please tell us a bit about your background and what prompted, or should I say, steered you towards a career in coaching with a focus on the mindset.
Well, my journey started 9.5 years ago, really, when I was diagnosed with breast cancer.
Okay.
I was in my late 40s at the time, and I was teaching. I've been a teacher for a long time. And I thought I was really fit and healthy, you know. So when I got the diagnosis, it came out of the blue, and it was really shocking and devastating and very, very scary.
Oh, wow.
So for me, I just wanted to know why me. And I thought, there has to be a reason for this. So I want to find out, A, why me, and B, how can I get rid of it and make sure it never comes back again? So I just started to think about my own health at that point, really.
Wow.
That's where it started.
Oh, wow. I can imagine, because those of us that have walked down that path, it is traumatizing. And thank God we're talking about mindset today, because actually the mind has been able to help me especially deal with my own challenges as well. Anyway, we'll get to that point as time goes on. So when we first connected, you had mentioned to me that you believed that stress plays a very important role in our health, and you felt that because you were stressed, that could have been tantamount to all that you were going through as regards your health. Why did you say that? Because I forgot to extract that part the last time.
I said that because when I was diagnosed and I was sat in the room and the oncologist was sat opposite me giving me this treatment package that, like they do, you know, this is going to happen, you're going to have surgery, you're going to have chemo, you're going to have radio, all of that kind of stuff, and it's going to take about 9 months. And
yes.
He said to me, and we would advise you not to go to work during that time, because particularly because of the job that I did.
Mm-hmm.
And in amongst all of the devastation and fear, when he said that, I felt this sense of relief. And my thoughts were, at least I don't have to go to work for 9 months, which is a very bizarre feeling to have in the middle of all this devastation.
Exactly.
So I needed to know why I was feeling that way, why I felt the sense of relief. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until during that 9 month period, that's when I really started to look at, you know, at my life and what was going on with it, that I realized that I had been chronically stressed for years. And I didn't know because it had become the norm for me. And the relief was the fact that the stress for me was related to my job, and therefore I could just get off the treadmill for a while and just sort of consolidate everything and wind down. So I thought, well, if I feel like that, that's not right. There's something going on here. So I started to research into both stress and the effects of chronic stress and nutrition. And those were the two things that really I knew that I could do something about, or at least I wanted to try to do something about to improve my own life chances and to ensure that, you know, if I could get rid of the cancer, that it would never come back again.
Yes.
So that was the wake-up call for me, that I had been stressed for a very, very long time. Mm-hmm. And so when I started to research stress, I read an awful lot, and I realized that although acute stress is normal and natural, and, you know, it's that fight or flight thing, it kept us going as a species when we were running away from woolly mammoths or whatever it might have been. Acute stress is short-lived. And once we get over that whatever it is that's chasing us, then things are supposed to calm down. Mm-hmm. Chronic stress is when it doesn't calm down. And so you're constantly living as if you're running away from a predator. Mm-hmm. And what I discovered was that when we are doing that and living in that state of chronic stress, that our immune system doesn't function properly, and our digestive system doesn't function properly, because these things, you know, if you're running away from a saber-toothed tiger, you don't want to be worrying about digesting food or your immune system.
Yes, your safety.
Yeah, exactly. So all, you know, all your energy is going into running away or fighting. So these things don't work. And if your immune system is not working properly over a long time, then mm-hmm. you are susceptible to both physical and mental diseases.
Thank you so much for that. Yeah, that really speaks a lot, because we're all of us, you know, it's a 24-hour, you know, 365 days a year kind of thing. Just the motion, the motion, the motion. And that really puts us in a very dangerous place. And coming from what you said, your relief at not wanting to go to work or not being able to go to work actually made you, in a sense, it was like some gift from God, if we must say so, in the sense that, oh, it now takes you to a place, well, I have to take care of me now.
Yeah.
And look inwards, you know. And it may not even have been the cancer that could have been destructive. It's the stress, actually, that would have been more destructive.
Mm. Yeah. It is a killer long term. Absolutely.
It is. It is. I've observed that because you now, as we go along, will be explaining where nutrition came in. But I wanna put this out there first. When you were trying to change certain things about you and nutrition came into play, for me, I've observed that nutrition is a very emotional subject. Mm. Many people I have discussed nutrition with are usually they usually freeze as if to say, I'm going to tell them what not to eat or what to eat and all that kind of thing. But that's not the case because information is key. You're trying to find out what works for you. Would it work for the other person too? But since you have now come in with nutrition, have you experienced what I've experienced before? And how did you broach the subject without making certain people feel uncomfortable?
That's a good question. And that's what I do in my coaching. So if somebody comes to me for nutrition coaching, so it doesn't matter whether it's that they want to lose weight or they just want to change their diet for health reasons. It doesn't matter. It's actually all about the mindset. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's so much information out there about what to eat and what not to eat. And so much so that it can be very confusing. So the last thing I do in a coaching session is tell somebody what they should or should not be eating.
Exactly.
I always start, before I even look at their food diary, which of course is something that I do, before I do that, I actually talk to them about why this is important to them. So if they want to lose weight, and they say, well, you know, my goal is I want to lose so many pounds. I will say, well, why is that important to you? Why do you want to do this? Because that's a short-term goal. It's almost meaningless. You know, why do you want to do this? What will it give you? What's the most important thing in your life? You know, I get people to think long-term about their families, what they want to be doing with their families in 5 years' time, in 10 years' time. How do they want to feel in their bodies? What do they want to be able to do with their grandchildren or whatever it might be? And actually, it's tapping into that. And that emotional side of things, that is the key. And if people can tap into that and really find why it's so important to them, then they are much more willing to change things. And then when we do get around to looking at food diaries, I never say to people, you shouldn't be eating this or you should be eating that. We look at what they're doing and we find simple steps and simple swaps that they can do, so that it doesn't feel so overwhelming and so drastic. Because if somebody tries to change too many things all at once, it's not going to work anyway. And small things add up to big things. So, you know, if somebody's never eaten a carrot before in their life, for instance, and they have one carrot a week, at the end of the first year, that's 52 carrots.
Mm-hmm. 52. You know,
so, yeah. So, you know, it's all about small steps, but it starts with the mindset.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. But as for you, why were you convinced that your change in diet and nutrition was actually very crucial to your healing after your cancer diagnosis?
I read a lot of books during that 9 months. You know, I had a lot of time to read, and so I read a lot of books, and I went online, and I found advice that I believed was right for me.
Yes.
And up to that point, I thought I was I had a healthy diet, but I realised that there were many things that were wrong, and so I began to make changes. And it was difficult to say at first because, of course, I was going through my treatment when I was making these changes, so I felt pretty ill anyway. It wasn't until after my treatment that I began to notice the difference in how I felt. So, you know, I had more energy. I certainly, and I know this is something you want to ask me about, but, you know, I gave up dairy. And I noticed that I had less mucus around, you know, it just, whether it's nasal mucus or, you know, whatever, I just felt that I felt very different not having that. And the other thing, because I stopped eating so much processed food, that I became less tolerant of it. And this is what I've noticed with clients too.
Less tolerant, you said?
Yes.
Okay.
If I can give an example of a client, it's probably more helpful. I had a client who was drinking lots of Diet Coke every day.
Wow.
She thought it was a good thing to do because she was trying to lose weight. And so I persuaded her to replace that with fizzy water, just plain fizzy water. She liked the fizzy thing. So she replaced it. And so she did. And she felt so much better. And then about 6 weeks later, she was at a family member's house. She was very hot. And she just went to the fridge and she opened the fridge and she drank, without thinking, she drank down half a can of Diet Coke. She hadn't had any for about 6 to 8 weeks. And she immediately felt ill. She got a headache. She started to feel jittery. And she knew instantly that it was a Diet Coke. She'd been drinking this stuff for years.
Mm-hmm.
And was okay.
It's like weaning one off. Yes, something.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, our bodies are incredible things. They know what's good for us if we allow ourselves to get in tune with our bodies and what's right for us in terms of nourishment.
Mm-hmm.
And once we do that, we find that we don't want the nasty stuff anymore.
No. Yes, definitely. Our bodies actually talk to us. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Because like during my own journey, I had to give up a lot of things. And seriously, when I see them now, I feel uncomfortable. I feel like puking sometimes. I try to contain the urge I have to puke, you know, something that I would, you know, Kentucky Fried Chicken or something like that, that I would eat on the go, you know, between work, between activities. I can't stand that too much anymore. Maybe once in a while, but it's not like, you know, before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you smell, you know, the smells put you off.
Yes. And the oils that they use, especially those oils, because the same oils are being used to do God knows how many sets of chickens all the time. So you see, it's like recycling oil all the time, you know, that affects us. So now that you've spoken about the changes, you know, less mucus, you felt better and everything. I would like to ask you, there's a fad even here in the United States. Everybody's vegan, 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 vegan. What exactly is vegan? And what's the difference between being vegan and being on a plant-based nutrition? But please tell us what being vegan means and encapsulates.
Yeah, well, according to the Vegan Society, you know, being vegan is sort of the abstinence of any animal products. So it's not just in food, it's, you know, not wearing leather, it's all of those sort of things. And for most vegans, and again, I can only speak for most vegans, but most vegans usually take this path because, you know, it's about animal welfare or it's about the environment or, you know, some other issue. So, so a vegan diet is obviously without anything to do with animal insect products at all.
And insects as well.
Well, yeah, any living thing, you know.
Any living thing.
Yeah. So, however, and this is where I sort of kind of feel a bit despairing, really, because it's the same in the UK. You know, it's very, very big, the vegan movement, and I understand that we eat far too much meat, and it's a really good thing to cut down. However, you can be a vegan and still eat a really unhealthy diet because just not eating meat and fish and dairy and other animal products, you know, you could live on processed food. I'm sure it's the same in the States as it is in
oh, it's worse.
Yeah, probably. you know, you can get vegan sausages and vegan bacon and vegan this and vegan that. It's just processed food. And it's often full of salt and sugar and chemicals. And it's not meant to be in our bodies. So it isn't good for us. So, you know, my worry, I think, for the sort of vegan bandwagon, if you like.
Yes.
Is that if people don't take care of their nutritional needs, then they are going to be seriously depleted and put things into their bodies that are more harmful than having meat. So that's the vegan side of things. Now, the plant-based diet is, people usually choose a plant-based diet for health reasons. Mm-hmm. And a plant-based is literally what it says. It's about eating whole fruit, whole vegetables, whole grains, nuts, seeds,
yes,
you know, anything that grows, really. And I mean, it can, you know, you can eat a mainly plant-based diet and eat fish occasionally, or eat a little bit of meat, or have some dairy in there too. But the predominant diet is whole fruits, whole mm-hmm. vegetables, whole grains, nuts, seeds, that kind of thing.
Okay.
So that's the difference really between, and of course it's less processed food, because the whole point about plant-based diet is that it's whole foods, real foods, if you like, clean foods.
Yeah, clean. Mm. So that's actually the difference between. So what are the health concerns, actually? Because every good thing has its cons as well. Let's put it that way. What would you say are the pros and cons of vegan diet and plant-based diet?
Well, I mean, as I've already said about the vegan diet, I think the mm-hmm. real concern is the fact that, you know, you can still eat very unhealthy food mm-hmm. on a vegan diet, because you can still eat a lot of processed foods. So that is my main concern. And of course, the lack of nutrients.
Absolutely.
And to be honest, whether you're eating meat or you're a vegan or you're a vegetarian, if you're eating a lot of processed foods, then you actually can be really malnourished. So whatever you're eating, it's about the nutrients that you're putting in your body and what you're doing with them. So you could actually be missing out on quite a lot. Vitamin B12, for instance, is a very obvious one.
Vitamin 12?
B12. B12, yes. Because it's mostly found in animal products, meat particularly. So
one should abstain from that? That nutrient, or
No, I'm saying you need that nutrient.
Oh, okay. Okay, I didn't hear you there. Yeah.
Sorry. but it's one that vegans and vegetarians and people on a plant-based diet may find that they can lack vitamin B12. Iron is another one. So, you know, I would say if you're going to be a vegan, or you're going to be just a plant-based diet, then you do need to look carefully at where you're going to get those vital B vitamins from, iron, zinc, you know, calcium, those sort of things. You need to look at where you're going to get them from. And certainly in the case of B12, baby supplements, because it's just so difficult to find outside of animal products.
Mm-hmm.
So I suppose I would say be more careful in terms of your nutritional content, but that can apply just as much to a meat eater too. You
know, I know.
It's finding that balance, and I, you know, I never judge anybody for whether they come to me and say, I'm a vegan, or I only have a plant-based diet, or I'm a pescatarian, or a vegetarian, or a meat, whatever. It's actually about, doesn't matter what, it's just about the nutrients and the proportion of them. You know, in our typical diet, and I can speak for, I know, America as much as I can the UK, we eat way too much meat. We have way too many carbs, particularly refined carbs. We have way too much sugar and processed foods. And not enough vegetables.
not enough at all. True. Yeah. Very, very true. You go to some restaurants and, you know, you just sit in your corner and watch what people, I've done this before, watch what people order.
Yeah.
And especially during, of course, festive periods and all that. Beef, 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 beef. Very minimal vegetables. Mm-hmm. Very minimal, you know, like side salads or whatever. Yeah. Everything is just... And I'm like, oh my goodness, this isn't good. But, you know, everybody has their own lifestyles. But these are things that have to be harped on, because even here in the States, it starts from a very young age. The kids are already, you know, conditioned to eating fast foods because parents are working. It's also the lifestyle. Yeah. Mom can't pack anything of nutritional value in the morning. It's up and go. On the way back from school, you pick up a takeaway and all that. And it's a vicious cycle. You know, it's everywhere. So these are things. This is what, I'm sorry, I want to key this in. This was what Michelle Obama was trying to, or what she had started doing. She had started a movement. Yeah. As regards kids here in the United States, what they eat at school, what they eat at home, and educating parents, having her own little farm, you understand, to grow for in her backyard there at the White House. And I think that should be brought back again, and, you know, awareness created or recreated again, because...
I think so, because a lot of people that I see, they want to eat healthy, but they don't know how. They don't know what to do with vegetables anymore. You know, we've lost that connection and that understanding. That actually, you know, there's a lot of myths out there about, well, eating healthily is boring. No, it's not. It's so I'm such a foodie, and, you know, I love food, but it's tasty. And people say, well, it's too expensive. I can't afford to live to eat healthily. It doesn't have to be. You know, pulses and lentils and stuff, it's so cheap.
Yeah.
And vegetables, you know, if you buy them seasonally, you buy them locally, they're not expensive.
Mm-hmm.
It's expensive.
Yeah, they say, oh, it's bland and all that. But it depends on how you can just rustle up something.
What you do with it. And all those spices and herbs that you can add.
Yes.
To
these things,
but just make it so wonderful.
You know, sometimes you just, without anything, you just create a storm in a wok with just veggies.
Oh, yeah.
And the aroma, you know, I'm hungry already.
I know. I think you and I could have very long conversations about food.
I swear, I mean, you know, so, oh, wow, that is, but okay, if for, like we were saying earlier, if for one, somebody came to you and said, okay, I know you look good and all that. I can be as trim as you, yes, and everything. And you say, and they say, okay, how can I change my diet? What tips would you give to the person to have a rethink regarding, not pushing them or whatever, just a few tips?
It's very, very personalized. So as I said to you before, I would really get into my mindset, first of all. So it would be very much about why they want it. What do they want to be doing? Where do they want to be going? First of all.
Yes.
So once we've got the mindset sorted out and I know they really, really want it, then we would look at food diaries. And so we would look at changing proportions of food. One of the things that I say to clients, and this is something that they always remember, is eat a rainbow. So if they were to put all of the food they ate on a day, on a
I love that. Eat a rainbow.
Eat a rainbow. If they put it on a big plate, all of the food that they had for one day, what would it look like? What colors would there be on there? Because that is an indicator of whether you are getting the nutrients that you should have or not. Because our typical Western diet is very beige. You know, very bland.
Bland.
A lot of carbs, and we have a lot of meat, you know, chicken and poultry or whatever. With the vegetables, it's the vegetables that are bright colors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and each of those colors have different nutrients in them. So this is why it's important to have the greens and the reds and the yellows and the purples. And, you know, the more variety that you can have, then... The more nutrients that you'll be having. I mean, I don't know what it's like in America, but in Britain we have this thing of five a day. You know, mm-hmm. We have to eat five a day, and that's five fruit and or vegetables a day. Five is nothing. Five is absolutely nowhere near enough. We should be eating 10, 15 plus a day if wow. we get all of the nutrients from all of those different things. You know, every vegetable has and every fruit has a different set of nutrients and phytonutrients in them. And so to have a big variety of those with lots of, you know, and all the different colors that they would encompass, then you know you're getting your nutrients.
Absolutely.
And also what that does is it tells you about proportions as well. You know, you said earlier about seeing in restaurants how you know, on a plate, probably half of the plate will be meat.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe, I don't know, another more than a quarter of it will be the carbs, and then there'll be a tiny little bit in the corner
of veggies,
a little bit of veg, you know,
that but, would hardly be eaten anyway.
I know that often get left. Yeah,
yeah.
And, you know, that is the wrong proportions, and of course it's going to look brown or beige or
mm-hmm.
you know. So to change that proportion, if it was to look like a rainbow, there would be a lot of vegetables on that plate.
Absolutely.
And there would be nuts and seeds and what I call concentrated nutrients, things like ginger and turmeric and cinnamon, all those lovely spices that could also be on that plate.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess my top tip is always, let's look at the colours. You know, I often get people to take a photograph of their plates, yeah, and then we can look at it and look at how we can make it more colorful, what we can add to it. So that's a start. That's where I like to start.
That is nice. That is really nice, without making them feel guilty.
Yeah.
guilty pleasures.
Oh, absolutely. You know, this is never about judgment, because
at all
we've been brought up to believe all this myth about low fat. And you know, we've been told all of this misinformation about food, and we've disconnected with food as nourishment.
True.
You know, we don't eat because we're thinking about the nourishment that we're going to get from it. We eat because we're on the go, or we're hungry, or it's meal time, or it's social thing, or whatever. So we're disconnected.
And comfort food. A lot of people are not happy, and they find food as a go-to for psychological reasons. So you find a lot of people are just in a corner, just eating away to distract themselves from certain troubles or worries and stuff like that. And you stuff and stuff and stuff. At the end of the day, your worries don't go away, and you're sicker. You know,
that's very true. And so for me, I would then look at the worries and what we can do with that.
Yes.
What else we can do with that? Either replacing it with other foods or finding other ways to help them to feel better about themselves without relying on bad food. Because very often when we do feel bad, we turn to the sugary foods and the carbs. Mm-hmm. And actually, we know that sugar is a mood depressant.
You know, yes, it is.
Sugar affects our moods greatly. You know, it disrupts everything. It disrupts our hormones. It disrupts our metabolism, and it disrupts our moods.
Yes. So,
you know, although we might reward ourselves with a bar of chocolate if we're feeling miserable, actually, half an hour later, we're going to feel just as miserable again, if not more.
Absolutely. More, because the chocolate is finished and you need to get more.
Yeah. Or you feel guilty for eating it.
No, I never feel guilty over chocolate.
To be honest, neither do I. And that's the other thing. You know, I never say to anybody that you should never eat chocolate again, or you shouldn't have this, should not. Of course, you know, when you're out on a special occasion, have a nice dessert, you know.
Or yeah. Give
a glass of wine and a piece of chocolate, whatever it might be. How often you do that?
Yes, it's how often.
You do the majority of the time. You know, if you're eating lots and lots and lots of veg, as well as the odd bit of chocolate, it's okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because, and you know, sometimes a lot of chocolate constipates. So you find that going to the loo too. Yes, it's true. You sit on the loo for so long, you know, because you're constipated. You didn't have any roughage. And you're just, you know, loading yourself with all that, you know, seriously. Yeah.
That's the thing about the veggies, you see. If you eat lots of
and
veggies,
fruits, yes.
Then what it does is, because of, like you say, there's lots of fiber, lots of roughage, it helps to extract all those nasty things that you do eat as well. So it detoxes you.
Yes.
So vegetables are the best detox thing that you can forget all the products that are detox this or detox that. No. Eat lots of veg and it will help to detox you.
Yeah, one of the when I was coming out of my illness and all that, I was doing, you know, the usual cabbage, blah, blah, blah. But my daughter introduced me to kale, hated it. I hated kale. But like you said, the way you know, when you stir fry and do a lot of stuff with it, I fell in love with kale. So now I have stir fried kale with butternut squash, linguine. Everything there, and then I now have garlic and mushrooms and everything in one wok.
Yes,
and I'm good to go. Nothing. If I have shrimps, okay. If there's nothing, I'm fine. And it's, you know, that is nourishment in a plate, I tell you.
Absolutely is. Yeah,
and you don't get hungry as often.
No.
It's filling.
That's right, and that's the other myth, that we need carbs to fill us. No, fats are really filling. So if you have stir fry and you've used a bit of oil in the wok, or you, like you say, you have some shrimp in there, or you know, something that's oily, that's going to fill you, and the protein will fill you.
Yes, it will.
You don't need carbs to fill you.
You don't. We had already spoken about dairy and but like I stopped having cow milk as well. You know, coming from my zone, let's put it that way, and then change to almond milk. And so that's what I do. But why do you think people are averse to cow milk now?
I think, I don't believe that we should be drinking cow's milk at all. I don't think it's meant for us. And again, I did lots of research when I was going through my treatment and discovered all kinds of things about cow's milk and the kind of chemicals that are put, you know, hormones and antibiotics and things. It's much worse in the States than it is here, because at least our cows are outside eating grass, which doesn't mean
what grass. That's the kind of thing with a lot of pesticides and things going on.
Yeah. So, I thought I'm gonna give up that. I think now, the thing is, with the internet, information is out there, and for a long time, all we were being, certainly in the UK, we were being told was you have to have cow's milk because it gives you calcium. And, you know, it's very nutritious. And, you know, we were given it as school children. And really, it's only recently since we now have access to our own research and we can find things out for ourselves that we've discovered that actually that's not necessarily true. We really don't need cow's milk for calcium. There's lots and lots of other ways we can get calcium into our diet without that, and better sources of calcium.
Absolutely.
So, I think there is a huge rise in the amount of things like oat milk and the nut milks and things that are around. So it's much easier. It's much easier now for me to have those alternatives than it was 9 years ago. It was only really just starting to kind of become a popular thing to not have cow's milk. I think people are noticing. And one of the big things that has become more, people are more aware of is that dairy, cow's milk particularly, is inflammatory. So, you know, inflammation is the root of all disorders, conditions and diseases.
Tumors.
So, yes, and tumors, yeah. So we want to reduce the inflammation in our body, and one of the ways we can do that is to cut out cow's milk. I know not everybody, I know it's controversial, and I know there are a lot of people who don't agree with that, but that's just my belief and my opinion.
Yes, yeah, from your own perspective, exactly. Mm. And I second that. Ever since I started taking almond milk, I felt better, honestly. I became less constipated. I found that after chemotherapy, I took milk and it was constipating me a lot because I was taking cow's milk saying, oh, okay, even if I don't have breakfast in the morning and I have to go for chemotherapy, at least I've lined my stomach. Mm. But I would throw up and, oh, it was nasty. And coming out of the treatments, and I got better. I found out that I couldn't keep cow's milk anymore.
Oh, that's
I didn't deliberately stay off cow's milk. I just had it with my cereal and I went straight to the bathroom. Mm. And I now started taking, I watched it over a period of time and saw that this was becoming too frequent. Mm. And my daughter was like, okay, change to some other milk. So we started using almond milk, and that's what I do, even for my lattes and stuff like that. That's what I take.
Mm. Okay.
So the constipation is not, you know, you don't get constipated and bloated and all that, you know.
So your body was telling you that.
Yes.
That was not right for you.
Yes, wasn't right. And also, thank God, you know, like you rightly said, we have to listen to our bodies.
Yeah.
Because I could have put it to something else, not the milk. Mm. But when you've come out from where we have come out from, every little thing is like ding, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
What is this? What could this be? Is it as a result of this? You know, so
much more aware of what's going on.
Very aware.
Yeah.
You're open now.
Yeah.
You're open, you're more aware because you're open to receiving those signals, as far as I'm concerned. You're open to receiving those signals. Yeah. So for anybody on diet and, you know, change of diet or whatever, especially for someone like you, what form of exercise do you partake in?
Again, I would say only do the exercise that you enjoy. So for me, I've never really enjoyed going to the gym. Never. I've tried it a few times.
I'm like that.
I just don't like that sterile environment.
Mm.
For me, it's about being outside. So I walk miles.
Yeah.
And you know, I know aerobic exercise is good, so I walk quite briskly.
Mm-hmm.
I like swimming. I don't do it as often as I'd like to, but I do like swimming. I like dancing.
Even yeah.
In the kitchen, you know, it's great sort of aerobic exercise. And I love yoga. I've just recently, only this year, I started doing Pilates, and I really, really like Pilates.
Nice.
I just find it really mindful, very gentle, and yet, you know, it has a strength to it. And so I find that really mindful. So, you know, I like doing things. I like walking by myself.
Yeah.
My headphones on, get in the zone, and I just go.
Yeah, I'm like that. Yeah.
But the other things, you know, the yoga and the Pilates, the swimming, I like to be with other people, you know. So for me, that's what I enjoy. You know, it's all about moving. So it doesn't matter. I've got a friend who's a real gym bunny, and she loves the gym. She's always, that's fine. It's fine.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's finding something you enjoy.
Yes.
Both aerobic and then something that's also strengthening. You don't have to lift weights. You know, you can garden, for instance, you know, or just I don't know, run around or something.
I mean, I'm so slim. What weights am I going to? You know, I mean, yeah, I do a few. I lift a few, weights now and get, when I was getting out of, after my lymph node surgery and all that, yes, took a while. I had to get my feelings back in my right arm. So, of course, I was advised to once in a while to exercise my arm after my lymph nodes, you know, were removed. Yeah. So, I built up some muscle. Yeah. But yeah. gym and all that, I'm not a gym person at all.
I believe it's a bit like the food thing, you know, being back to nature, what we're meant to mm-hmm. eat. And it's the same, you know, we're meant to walk miles. So that's mm-hmm. fine. And the other thing I would say about that for me is because I have a tendency to go back to those stress cycles, if I'm not careful, you know, I can go back to those patterns. So for me, if I feel, and now I know, I didn't know then, but now I know when I'm feeling stressed, I just take myself for a walk. And being in nature is the most calming thing.
Yes.
And that's just not anecdotal. There's loads of research to suggest mm-hmm. that even looking at nature actually has an effect on your body, and it releases the sort of endorphins that you need to keep calm and happy and reduces the stress hormones.
Absolutely.
So, you know, absolutely. And I know you live in a very busy city. Where I live, it's a city, but there's a lot of green spaces. But, you know, mm-hmm. we can all find a little patch of green somewhere.
Yes.
It doesn't have to be a forest. It can just be a little park or, you know, somewhere under a tree somewhere, you know. That actually is very, very good for you.
It's necessary.
Well, I was reading fairly recently that apparently trees... obviously they breathe, and when they breathe out, they release chemicals that we then breathe in, and they are anti-cancer chemicals. They actually can help to reduce tumors.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Wow. You've got to send me that link.
I will do.
Please do.
And so much so that the Japanese, in certainly, you know, places like Tokyo, that's a very, very built up city. Mm-hmm. They now do something called forest bathing. So they will actually go and spend, you know, half a day or a day in the forest, taking in that all of that good stuff.
Yeah.
And it lasts for several days. You know, that well-being and that mm-hmm. that sort of boost that you get to your well-being lasts for several days. So, you know, this wow. is science stuff. This is not airy-fairy stuff. This is science.
No. Yeah, and I was also reading that actually our mental health gets better when we're in outdoor spaces.
Oh, yeah.
Where there's a lot of greenery, yeah. and people tend to live longer. Mm. People who live in, you know, more green areas tend to have longer lifespans than those, obviously, that live in the cities. Mm. You know, so that's why they encourage people to go to the parks, to yeah. hike, to do, you know, those anywhere to take you out of yeah. of the what should I say, pavements and cars and all that, yeah. breathing in all them crazy
fumes
and stuff like that. Yeah.
And again, it's being disconnected again. You know, when we are in an office in the middle of a tower block, in the middle of a town, all we can hear is cars and
bam, bam. Yeah.
We're disconnected with yeah. nature, and we, you know, we are all part of the same universe. So, you know, to reconnect is very good for our mental health.
Yes.
So yeah. I've done a couple of blogs on my website about this. I will send you the link to them. Particularly
absolutely.
About me going through my treatment and how I think that's where I put the research in, actually, on that blog.
Please, could you post your link on my page on Facebook sure. For also my friends and the community to actually Anyway, they're going to be seeing a lot of you, so that's the, but I would love them to read up on a lot of stuff that you have available and all that, you know.
Yeah,
that's good. So you were telling me also that you facilitate. I know you do a lot of workshops and all that. And these workshops, are they just for people with challenges, health challenges, or a potpourri of sorts? What
really
else do you organize?
It's a real mixed bag, actually. You know, I do talks and I do workshops, and I get invited. This is why I love what I do, because
yes,
I get invited by so many different groups. So, mm-hmm. you know, I might be doing a talk to a group of cancer patients,
mm-hmm.
Or I've been into education establishments, teach training students, and helping them to sort of with things like resilience. And you know, it's a very stressful job they're going into, so you know, helping them with resilience. Another thing that I'm passionate about, because it's something again I experienced, was the menopause. So I do talks about raising awareness of menopause. Done a couple of podcasts on that too.
Nice.
And I'm also going to be in the next month doing a corporate workshop. So it's the mindset stuff and how that can help with relationships in the workplace, and you know, how that can lead to just general well-being in the workplace, and mm-hmm. therefore increased productivity. So you know, it lends itself to so many different things, really.
Yes, it does, honestly. And of course, workforce, workplace, you know, the stresses that go with it. So it's fabulous that you're able to give your take in those places, you know. Stress everywhere.
The stress, it always, you know, it always comes up in whatever I'm doing, really. We've got a bit of a crisis as far as stress is concerned. So, you know, the more I can do. And I think for me, this was something that I guess I discovered. After I discovered that I was chronically stressed, what I then realized, and this was through the training I did, was a bit of a light bulb moment, that we can do something about it. That we don't have, it's not, what happens to us out there doesn't cause us stress. They're just triggers. It's how we react to them that actually makes the difference. And what I discovered was that we have a choice. We don't have to react to them that is in a way that's unhelpful to us. And of course, that all links into what we believe. That's all the mindset stuff, you know. Very often, if we, you know, for me, just as an example, the things that would trigger my stresses at work were actually because deep down I had this long-held belief that I wasn't good enough. And I didn't know that. It's an unconscious belief. But when you realize that, then, of course, it leads you to understand that, well, of course I'm getting stressed about this, because deep down, I don't think I'm good enough. So once you know that, then you can do things about replacing it. Just a belief, not true. It's just something that, you know, I've learned to believe in my childhood. So mm-hmm. That's the fascinating thing about the mindset for me, is finding these unconscious beliefs. Once we find them, we can change them. And that then can have a knock-on effect on things like stress, because we're all going to experience bad stuff. You know, bad stuff happens.
Always.
And, you know, just the things that we've talked about, you know, actually being in a building and being disconnected to nature. People are living in those sort of environments. However, there's still a lot they can do by changing their mindset, and therefore changing the way they react to those situations. And it makes a huge difference. Huge difference. Certainly makes you calmer and happier.
You look calm and happy. I'm staring at you. You look amazing, Alison. Well, honestly, you look fresh. That's the word.
Oh, bless you.
You look fresh, really.
Well, do you know, I was really quite nervous about doing this. And you, because I know we've had a conversation before, you just help, you know, you really do help me to feel calm. So,
bless your heart.
I feel really calm and still at the moment because I'm talking to you.
You know, I don't know, a lot of people that I've spoken to said, Grace, maybe it's that I've done mental health and a lot of stuff, but a lot of people say, you know, sometimes I get so worked up, I need to talk to Grace. There's just something, she just has this calming effect, you know, on us. So it's a good thing. Thank you. It's a good thing. Even what we go through every day, you know, as survivors, especially when you're thinking, oh, is it going to come back or whatever. But we, like you said, our mindset is the matter. We have to take care of it and just
and control it and not let it control you. And just, you know, I know we were sort of having a little joke there, but that's the other thing. We can choose to us, to some extent anyway, we can choose who we are around, because some people are toxic and they will drain our energy and they will bring us down, and other people like you and I
we
have this effect on other people. They want to be around us.
Yes, so, they do.
And so I think tuning into how another person makes you feel is really quite useful, because I know we can't do a lot about our families, but certainly with our friends, we can choose who we spend time with.
Yes, and who appreciates us.
Yeah, absolutely.
Appreciation is very important. Mm. You wouldn't want to be with anybody, male, female, or groups who are not putting in the same effort that you are putting into the relationship.
Absolutely.
I always ask people to walk away. I walk away from toxic relationships. Oops, I'm out. And I don't need to explain anything, because it's good for your mental health and it's good for your, we're still healing. We're not out of it yet. We'll be healing for life.
Yes, definitely.
You're a cancer survivor for life. Mm. It's not over, you know. That is our label, cancer survivor. But we just add it and say cancer warrior. We're cancer warriors.
I like that one.
So I would say I'm a cancer warrior. You know, we've fought.
And, you know, that in itself is a mindset, isn't it? Because, you know, I know, and I'm sure you feel the same. Every day I practice gratitude. I find gratitude is absolutely huge. It is so powerful.
Very.
And you know, I was a real moaner before.
Doesn't look it.
Well, I was, and I still have my moments. But you know, I know what to do. If I start to feel sorry for myself or start to moan or whatever, I know what to do. I just go and I write a journal. I write what I'm grateful for today, and it can be something really, really small.
Yes.
Or it can be something like my life, because I'm still here. You know, it doesn't matter. It's actually feeling it. It's feeling that feeling of gratitude. And you can't feel gratitude and stress at the same time.
It's not
possible. They are different chemicals that get released in the body. Totally different. So, you know, if you're feeling stress, going to the gratitude, you know, go outside, be grateful that you can hear the birds singing or whatever it might be, it will reduce your stress levels and it will increase those feel-good hormones, and they will get replaced. You will go back into a state of balance.
Yes.
Gratitude is huge.
Gratitude is huge. I'm grateful every second. I mean, I sing it, I say it, it's on my wall, it's everywhere. I play my music, I dance, even if I'm in pain, you know, because I'm like, God still kept me here. God still keeps us here. For what reason, we don't know. We're not better than those who have gone, you know, but we give thanks to to the heavens for keeping us here. And we're still taking that walk, you know, every single day, just that walk. Yeah. Like you were saying, stress and gratitude cannot stay together. It's like light and day. It's like darkness and night, you know, darkness and day, light and day. They can't, you know, exist in the same, on the same level.
No, darkness cannot exist where there is light.
Mm-mm.
And it's the same principle, really.
Yeah.
And sometimes it takes effort to shift that. Not always easy, you know. If we get into that pattern of oh woe is me or whatever it might be, it's not always easy to actually physically pick yourself up and do something about it. And so it is a choice. And because I've been doing this for a few years now, I sometimes get people say to me, "Well, I guess you've got it then. You're sorted." No, of course not. This is a journey for the rest of my life. I've had to change my neural pathways in my brain.
Awesome.
To fire in you know, new neural pathways have had to fire. They've had to change. My thought processes have had to change. So it fires off different neurons. I've got to keep working at that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every day. This is something that there's no quick fix. It's not like taking a pill. This is a lifestyle choice.
Yes, and it's your decision.
It is.
It's absolutely a decision one has to take and make and take.
Mm. Yeah, it's a choice. I mean, you don't have to do it, but
no, you don't.
Consequences are there, and so I think once you actually experience it and know the difference that it can make, then you don't want to go back to those old ways anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I know sometimes when I do workshops on gratitude, I know that sometimes people in the audience are thinking, oh, this is a bit sort of airy-fairy hippie stuff. No, do you know what? This is science now. They can prove this stuff actually works. So, you know, choosing your thoughts, choosing gratitude, actually releases chemicals in your brain that then affect how you feel and your well-being. This is science.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, it is science. And this is something one has to spread awareness on it, because a lot of people don't know. They're like, what the hell are you talking about? How could this be possible? How is this true? Yes, it is true.
Yeah, I think most people don't know. I think most people, particularly when I've done stress awareness workshops, most people come with that sort of, it's somebody else's fault. You know, I'm the way I am because of just because of my job or because of my partner or because of whoever, whatever. Giving away your power, saying, you know, it's somebody else's fault rather than it's not them. It's how you are reacting to
it. And owning up to it. Owning up.
Owning it, definitely.
That my mother used to say, most times we are the cause of what happens to us because of the way we have related and the way we have accepted. Because had we not accepted, you would have put a stop to those kind of things way before, you know, it started happening to you.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. Your mum's very wise lady. That's absolutely right. Putting yourself at cause.
Yes.
Not at effect.
Exactly. You know?
And it's powerful and it is empowering. It's a good thing to know that you can have some control over this.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Wow, Alison, this is so fantastic. I don't know. I like back to the nutrition bit. Like I said before, our topic was mindset, nutrition, and healing. We thank God for you. We thank God that you were able to go in, have deep reflection to be able to know where the lapses were, you know, stress level, nutrition and all that, and to bring you to the back to the beauty that you are now. And no, true. I look at you and yeah, you're a good advertisement for what you do. You don't need anybody to do anything for you. Seriously, it's brightened up my day. So yeah, I had to eliminate beef. I do chicken, seafood and all that. But take me down what you would have for. Just so I may be doing something wrong, so I could copy you now. What is your advice for breakfast? What would you advise for lunch and dinner?
Okay.
What would you? Because I'm writing it down. I'm writing it down now.
Okay. Well, first I would say it is different for everybody. We're all very different. So what suits one person doesn't always suit another. However, of course, there are things that are particularly good for you. So for breakfast, this time of the year it's getting colder, so I like a nice warm breakfast. So it's porridge, just proper rolled oats, you know, nothing that comes in a package, just proper rolled oats. And I like berries in it. Berries are out of season, but if they're frozen, then they were frozen in season, and they're great to put in a porridge with and nut milk, almond milk. I like to put sprinkle of cinnamon or nutmeg on it, or a spoonful of really good peanut butter. Oh, I love peanut butter in porridge.
I love peanut butter, but in porridge, oh my goodness. Are you serious? I'll try that.
With half a chopped banana on the top.
It's so good. So oatmeal, peanut butter, and a chopped banana. Yeah. I'm gonna try that tomorrow.
With either oat milk or almond milk. Yeah, it's so almond. Delicious.
Are you kidding me?
Honestly, try it. Let me know what you think.
I will. I'm gonna reach out to you.
The other thing, I like muesli, but I make my own. So it's just oats with lots of nuts and seeds and some dried fruit or some fresh berries in it. And again, sometimes at this time of the year, I like the warm almond milk on it.
Right.
So that's a kind of breakfast. There's also buckwheat breakfast. That's a recipe that I adapted from, forgotten her name. She's a vegan chef. Anyway, it'll come to me. But it's buckwheat, and it's got cacao powder and orange, fresh oranges in it as well. So it's very chocolate orangey.
Nice.
That's a really nice one. And or, you know, if I've got the time or at weekends, then I like eggs. I love eggs with mushrooms, tomatoes, avocado. Yes.
That's a full one.
Yeah. My son, one of his favorites is scrambled eggs with mashed avocado with lots of a bit of chili and olives, chopped olives in it.
Nice. When I come to the UK, we're gonna go. Yeah. Oh my goodness.
Oh yes. We'll have good breakfast. So yeah, that's the kind of thing I would have for breakfast. And lunch, and this time of year again, I make a lot of homemade soup. They're just so cheap to make. And any vegetables, we get an organic veg box delivered once a week. And it's a Wednesday. So for instance, today it's leftover vegetables, it's whatever's left. And you can put anything in a soup.
Yes.
And make it tomato-y or make it coconut milk. I like coconut milk in
soup. So do I, in everything.
Yeah,
I use coconut milk for everything.
Well, tonight we had a curry with some red rice, and it was coconut based curry, so coconut milk in it. And leftover veg, including kale, lots of kale, and a few shrimps too.
Yeah, so, that's good.
Yeah, I mean, I tend to have, I love winter foods like stews and cottage pie. Have cottage pie in the States?
Yes.
Yeah. But I do it without the meat most of the time, or I put very little meat in it. Mm. But you can replace that with lentils and beans and pulses. Mm. And if you put things and vegetables.
Potatoes.
Yes. Sweet potatoes, squash. Mm.
Squash, yes.
And with a little bit of cumin and turmeric, and you know, you can put ginger in it and tomato paste. It can be as tasty as a meat dish.
Wonderful.
So that this time of the year, I eat a lot of salads in the summer, but this time of the year, I like something warm and comforting.
Oh yes, is it? What's the weather like there today? Is it nice and sunny or just fresh?
You know, it's neither. We have had so much rain. It's not cold.
Kidding me?
But it's just so much rain, and I live in a part of the UK that doesn't get much rain. Mm-hmm. The driest part of the country. We've just had rain for days and days and days. So
that's climate change for real.
Oh yeah. Oh, it really is. This is not right.
Oh wow.
Yeah. So.
Oh, Alison. I know it's late there. I want to thank you. Honestly, you've been so wonderful to have given me this time, and for you to have come on the show and all that. You've answered very, very pertinent questions. And I'm sure anybody that would watch our video would really learn a lot from what, you know, we have discussed and what you have proferred as regards advice and going forward as regards mindset. And most probably nutrition. Who knows who we may be speaking, you know, talking to as regards that. So before we round up, do you have any last word of advice and all for anyone who is going through any challenges or who feels, you know, that they need a kind of change in mindset? What would you say?
I would say find someone locally that can help you with that, because changing mindset can happen. And you know, it doesn't have to be a coach or a therapist. It could just be someone that's close to you that has a positive outlook and that cares about you and wants to support you. But just know that you can change it. It is within your power to do that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I would say all of the things that, I mean, we've talked about so many things, really.
Yeah, honestly.
Getting out in nature and, you know, there's something in NLP, which is what I practice, about changing your state. And so when we sit and we go over the same thoughts over and over again, one of the best ways to start that process of change is to move, physically move. You know, get up from where you are sitting or lying or wherever you are, go into another room, go into a brighter space, or go outside, as I said before. Just the act of moving informs your body, which then informs your mind. Actually, I want to stop this. I want to interrupt this thought pattern.
Fantastic.
And so
that is awesome.
Just know it can be done and that you have the power to do it.
That is wonderful. That is so wonderful. And I'm going to, you know, adopt that as well. And I'm going to share it. Get up, move. Because by remaining seated or remaining standing while having all those negative notions, definitely they'll tend to, they envelop us.
Yes, they do.
They envelop us. Yes, yes. And we really have to tear ourselves. It's our mind. And we should be in control of our minds.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, that's this fantastic advice. Thank you so much for that. That is awesome.
You're welcome.
So.
Good fun, Grace. I enjoyed it.
Yeah,
it's just like, we're just chatting.
No, but we are chatting, I swear.
Yeah, we are.
Yeah, but I know, what time is it there now?
It's about, it's almost 9 o'clock in the evening.
So we've done pretty well.
Mm.
Yeah. So I will be rounding up and leaving you to go back to family. Thank you so, so much, Alison, for everything. You've been a fantastic, wonderful guest. Very great.
Thank you for having me.
Gracious of you, and for sharing your thoughts and for opening up about everything concerning your life and your mindset. And we're going to do this again some other time on another topic, I assure you. Yeah. We have bonded now. After all, what would we do without a good mindset? Huh?
Absolutely.
Yeah. All right, then. Let me round up. So, my dear audience and friends, I'm sure you're going to get a lot from this particular interview I've had with this amazing guest, Alison Harris. We can't survive without a positive mindset, and we cannot survive without good food, healthy food for that matter. So you are what you eat. Experiment. Except you have any health issues, even as we get older, we must cut down or eliminate certain types of food. Just eat healthy, everything in moderation if you can't. Don't go overboard, okay? So if you haven't joined our community, please do so as soon as possible. Like and follow us on Cancer Convos with Grace B on Facebook, and hover along to YouTube and subscribe and like as well, Cancer Convos with Grace B. There you'd be able to get updates on uploaded videos. So, my dear audience and friends, there you have it.